So Kamala Harris had a big interview. She had a huge in your face kind of interview, and I'm going to play some clips of it. Many of you might get brain damage, so don't sue Hard Lens Media. You've been warned, because you're going to learn about holistics. You're going to learn about, well, what it means to how Americans can fix their current financial situation, because, you know, everybody's broke. Beware for stupidity. It's going to hit you hard. And what better way to talk about Kamala Harris's madness and insanity by actually playing this portion of the interview? Viewer discretion should be advised if you value your brain power.
Vice President, you just laid out your economic vision for the future.
Yeah.
But still, there are lots of Americans who don't see themselves in your plans. For those who say these policies aren't for me, what do you say to them?
Well, if you are hardworking, if you have the dreams and the ambitions and the aspirations of what I believe you do.
If you believe in what you do and what I think you do, this isn't an answer. It's a word salad. Just one more time. I'm sorry. I'll try not to rewind too much, but if you think you're going to get an answer, you're wrong.
Who have the dreams and the ambitions and the aspirations of what I believe you do. You're in my plan. You know, I have to tell you, I really love and am so energized by what I know to be the spirit and character of the American people. We have ambition. We have aspirations. We have dreams. We can see what's possible. We have an incredible work ethic. But not everyone has the access to the opportunities that allow them to achieve those things. But we don't lack for those things. But not everyone, you know, gets handed stuff on a silver platter. And so my vision for the economy, I call it an opportunity economy, is about making sure that all Americans, wherever they start, wherever they are, have the ability to actually achieve those dreams and those ambitions, which include
No, but what are you going to do, genius? Because even corporate media, and I'll play those clips too, even corporate media has a hard time defending this. They don't know. They don't know what she's saying. Never forget, even Oprah Winfrey's face when she was doing that interview with Kamala. Even Oprah's like, even the Oprah cannot help you.
For middle-class families, just being able to know that their hard work allows them to get ahead, right? I think we can't and we shouldn't aspire to have an economy that just allows people to get by. People want to do more than just get by. They want to get ahead. And I come from the middle class.
Yes, she comes from the middle class, right? Let's talk about her job at Mickey D's.
Yeah, you know, yes,
okay, for a small period of time. But then let me ask about a big job.
But to your point, if you don't mind, before you get to the big job. There's a part of the reason I even talk about having worked at McDonald's is because there are people who work at McDonald's in our country who are trying to raise a family. I worked there as a student. I was a kid who worked there trying to raise families and pay rent on that. And I think part of the difference between me and my opponent includes our perspective on the needs of the American people. And what our responsibility then is to meet those needs.
And to the big job. You have laid out,
yes, the big job. But there's also the fact of, how are you going to get these policies passed if you have no real solid way whatsoever to actually get the GOP to support you? Because, you know, she's going to have to contend with Republican lawmakers, including Democratic lawmakers. And a huge shout out to Gray Walker, joint third party, who said, my plan's got electrolytes. And antiwar.com chatter X says, that's why they call it the American dream, because you got to be asleep to believe it. There you go. And BW says, Kit, this breaks the Geneva Convention. Well, yeah, well, we're breaking the Geneva Convention. Get ready for this one.
Expanding that child tax credit, or you mentioned housing before, giving that extra money for a first home. If you can't raise corporate taxes, or if GOP takes control of the Senate, where do you get the money to do that? Do you still go forward with those plans and borrow?
Well, but we're going to have to raise corporate taxes, and we're going to have to raise, we're going to have to make sure that the biggest corporations and billionaires pay their fair share. That's just it. It's about paying their fair share.
Expanding that child tax.
Everyone gets their fair share, but what is the answer? Answer the question. What are you going to do? How are you going to fix things? Because there's another point that we got to bring up here. And that is what's happening at the border. So let's go ahead and pull up this video here. The crisis at the border. What could go wrong, folks? What could go wrong?
Conservative members of the United States Congress came together with others, proposed a border security bill that would have put 1,500 new border agents on the border to help those hardworking border agents who are there right now working around the clock. Would have put more money into stemming the flow of fentanyl, which is killing Americans around our country and devastating communities. Would have put more resources into our ability to prosecute transnational criminal organizations, which in my career I've prosecuted. Donald Trump got word of the bill, realized it was going to fix a problem he wanted to run on, and told them to kill the bill, don't put it up for a vote. He killed a bill that would have actually been a solution because he wants to run on a problem instead of fixing a problem. And that's part of what needs to be addressed. And my pledge is that when elected president, if the American people will have me, I will bring that bill back and I will sign it into law. And we need a comprehensive plan that includes what we need to do to fortify not only our border, but deal with the fact that we also need to create pathways for people to earn citizenship.
And I want.
She has no plan to fix the crisis at the border. And listen. I know there's a lot of people in the conservative sphere who talk about the crisis at the border. Let's be very clear here, my friends, everybody across the political spectrum. The reason why there's a crisis at the border is because of the decades of previous Democratic and Republican presidential administrations that have been enacting horrific sanctions, coups, and of course, supporting the ridiculous war on drugs. It's caused a lot of political instability in Central and South America. You know, a rational person, you know, with drug lords to the left of them, dictators to the right of them, and they're stuck in the middle with them, a rational person is going to probably look around and say, gee, I got to either get myself and or if they have a family, hey, I got to get my family up out of here. Which is, again, leads to the crisis at the border, which leads to the crisis in sanctuary cities, which, again, continues to fuel on all this misinformation. And that's why there's madness and insanity at the border, because of Democratic and Republican politicians. And just for those of you who may not remember this, but any time prohibition was ever implemented, it has failed miserably. You know, the war on drugs is still ongoing. Who's buying the drugs? Mr. and Mrs. America. And who's getting Americans addicted to, you know, drugs? Well, we could thank corporations like Johnson & Johnson, you know. The reason why we got an opioid epidemic here in this country is because of these corporations getting Americans addicted, because everybody's in pain. Everybody's suffering. Everybody's desperate. Everybody's broke. It's a 1-6 cycle. The only people who are profiting, of course, is the prison industrial complex, the military industrial complex, big banks, Wall Street, big pharma, and the politicians. That's why there's a crisis at the border. You think Kamala's going to say anything? No. But she does have a holistic response. Holistically. If you think I'm joking, I'm not.
And assistance to state and local governments around transit dollars. And looking holistically at the connection between that and housing. And looking holistically at the incentives we in the federal government can create for local and state governments to actually engage in planning in a holistic manner that includes prioritizing affordable housing.
She said it 3 times. Now, we here at Hardlands Media believe in encouraging people to learn new words. So let's find out what the word holistic means together, all of us. Let's go ahead, have fun. Hardlands Media getting its learn on. Holistic. characterized by the belief that the parts of something are interconnected and can be explained only by reference to the whole. The solution demands a holistic approach and a strategic vision of what can be achieved. It's an adjective, by the way. And that is the sentence that it's used. It almost seems like Kamala Harris wrote that. Or in medicine, characterized by a treatment of the whole person, taking into account mental and social factors rather than just the symptoms of an illness. Many people conclude that holistic medicines are beneficial. Do you think Washington, D.C. is going to have a holistic response to our economy? Type one for yes kit, and it'll be great. 3 meals a day, roof over our heads, full tank of gas in my car, groceries paid for. Everything's okay with a holistic approach. Type one, if you think that's really good for us. Type two, what do you mean holistic response, man? Ain't gonna happen. We're all gonna be broke. Holistically, this can happen. But, my lovelies, my beautiful people, the interviewer who did that big interview was Kamala. Actually, I had this to say, and I find it hilarious.
Talk about that answer. I do, but here's what's a little tricky. She doesn't answer the question.
Oh! Yo! BSDNC with the gut check. She doesn't answer the question. She just says words and words and more words. What?
Ooh, but here's what's a little tricky. She doesn't answer the question around if the GOP is controlling the Senate, if she can't raise corporate taxes, where is she going to get the money from, to expand the child tax credit and do all the things she wants to do? And she says, we just have to do it. And that's great. And that's a campaign promise. But the issue is, if it means we're just going to borrow again, then what we're doing is we're just never addressing the deficit. And back in the days when you were a proud Republican, debts and deficits mattered. Talk about that, Al.
That was beautiful. That was beautiful. It's only 34 seconds long, but it was 34 seconds of pure gold. Pure gold. Pure gold indeed. But I want to thank all of you so much for laughing at this with me. Let's listen to this one more time. Just one more time, because the fact that it was BSDNC saying it, of all things. Mwah, I love it.
Answer. I do, but here's what's a little tricky. She doesn't answer the question around if the GOP is controlling the Senate, if she can't raise corporate taxes, where is she going to get the money from, to expand the child tax credit and do all the things she wants to do? And she says, we just have to do it. And that's great. And that's a campaign promise. But the issue is, if it means we're just going to borrow again, then what we're doing is we're just never addressing the deficit. And back in the days when you were a proud Republican, debts and deficits mattered. Talk about that answer.
We got one more, though. Shout out to Hotspot. Let's play this.
And one could watch that and say, well, she didn't give a clear, direct answer. That's okay, because we are not talking about clear or direct issues.
Once again, MSNBC, you disappoint me. On one hand, you do a little punch in the gut, and on the other hand, you go right back to this. Say that again.
And one could watch that and say, well, she didn't give a clear, direct answer. That's okay, because we are not talking about clear or direct issues.
The question about inflation and prices, this to me is one of the... It's sort of one of the most frustrating aspects of this campaign. The thing that people are 100% correct.
Yes, they're realizing that they have nothing. She has nothing. Kamala has nothing. And of course, look, this wouldn't be hard lens media without the other side, because Fox News saw this. And yes, Fox News is no different than the rest of corporate media. But look, this has been a tough week. And I think we all deserve a little laugh.
And I'm so energized by what I know to be the spirit and character of the American people. We have ambition. We have aspirations. We have dreams. We can see what's possible. We have an incredible work ethic. But not everyone has the access to the opportunities that allow them to achieve those things. My vision for the economy, I call it an opportunity economy, is about making sure that all Americans, wherever they start, wherever they are, have the ability to actually achieve those dreams and those ambitions. I come from the middle class. Look, my mother raised my sister and me. She worked hard. She saved up. By the time I was a teenager, she was able to buy our first home. And, you know, home ownership for too many people in our country now is elusive. You know, gone is the day of everyone thinking they could actually live the American dream.
Kamala was just asked about her policies. She rambled and then said the American dream is gone.
Yeah, she did. And look, just so you guys know, I did sit through that interview. And I think I'm forever mentally scarred again. I think the longer I sit in front of corporate media, the more brain cells I lose. And pretty soon I'll be nothing but a vegetable. And when that happens, please carry on the banner of speaking truth to power, because this election cycle, it's not disappointing. But what is disappointing is that there are people twisting themselves over and over again, defending Kamala's policies and who she is.
She's been in power for 4 years and said the American dream's gone. She just sank her campaign. But that was just the beginning.
How do you go after price gouging without implementing price controls? Because once we get in this zone, people start to get worried and they say, I don't know what she stands for.
So just to be very frank, I am never going to apologize for going after companies and corporations that take advantage of the desperation of the American people.
Does she talk about Steve Mnuchin? Does she talk about how times she's withheld evidence, especially that infamous situation where Tulsi Gabbard gave her a gut check in regards to how Kamala Harris's office withheld evidence, keeping an innocent man on death row? Again, death row. It's when you hear that word, it's kind of like final curtain call, okay? And an innocent man is there to boot as well. My goodness. Why would you withhold evidence? Why did you make sure that even some of the criminal firefighters couldn't even become firefighters once they served their time and actually, you know, get trained up to become real firefighters? What a sight that would be.
Yeah, I'm going to go after them. Yes, I'm going to go after them.
So price controls are still on the table. That's not going to fly in this country. What about trade policy?
Tariffs.
Yes, one more. And then I got to stop the abuse, because you, my audience, have been through so much pain. I can't put you through any more pain.
Aren't unique to President Trump. President Biden has tariffs in place. He's actually looking to potentially implement more. Where do you come out on? Is there a good tariff, a bad tariff?
Well, part of it is you don't just throw around the idea of just tariffs across the board. And that's part of the problem with Donald Trump. I say this in all sincerity, he's just not very serious about how he thinks about some of these issues. And one must be serious and have a plan, any real plan, that's not just about some talking point ending in an exclamation at a political rally, but actually putting the thought into what will be the return on the investment, what will be the economic impact on everyday people.
Was that an answer? The answer is no, it wasn't. And yet now, if you look at some of the articles, corporate media is trying to defend everything that she's been saying. She's been saying a whole lot of nothing. Where was her support animal, Tim Walz, at? Where was he at? You see, when Kamala's finally put before the cameras, people are now being reminded why she was such an epic failure in 2019. Just so you guys know, the same thing happened early. As soon as Kamala made her announcement, there was a big uproar from corporate media. Everybody was singing praises for Kamala. But then something interesting happened. The more she spoke, the more people went, ugh. And yet, because so many people are triggered by Donald Trump, 4 years after the Democratic primary, people were blinded with the belief that Kamala was going to save the day after Biden dropped out. Somehow Kamala was going to be the person in charge. But yet corporate media and all the diehard vote blue, no matter who, people are forgetting that she was the least popular VP in U.S. history. My goodness, even Dick Cheney had better numbers than her. And that's not saying much, but oh, wait, Dick Cheney endorsed her. So did Putin. Isn't that hilarious? So many people are supporting Kamala. So many people are going to bat for her. But yet, when she speaks, she says nothing but word salads. You know, people forget that the Biden and Harris team really weren't meshing together, weren't working together properly. And everyone's forgetting that Kamala hemorrhaged a lot of her staff members. So many of them she hemorrhaged. And I have to sit here and believe that somehow she's going to be a leader. Now, we've seen our fair share of leaders, men and women, who are phenomenal at their jobs throughout history, be it now, currently in the present, or in antiquity. But we've also seen our fair share of leaders, men and women, who are absolute fools and morons. Kamala's in that fools and morons sector, okay? And yet we seem to have got a bottom of the barrel, Trump versus Kamala. Now, I was kind of looking forward to Biden versus Trump again, the 2020 rematch, but I think it's very clear that Biden's brain isn't all there. But I don't know if Kamala's working on full power as well, which kind of makes me laugh at again how Nancy Pelosi was yelling at Jake Tapper, saying, "How dare you say that Kamala or repeat Trump's talking point that Kamala is lacking cognitive abilities to be aware of the situation." Through those clips that we played, did any of you hear any policy about how it was going to make your life better? Be you liberal, green, libertarian, Republican, independent? Where do you stand for that? Like, did you hear anything that's going to inspire you and give you the enthusiasm to go out there and vote for Kamala? I'm not seeing it. Now, here at Hard Lens Media, I'm speaking for myself here, this election's 50-50. It's up in the air. And of course, some people will type in the comment section below, "Oh, but the polls are showing this and the polls are showing that. And this is happening here and that's happening here. And look at how Kamala is succeeding over Trump." And to which I have to say, I've seen this before. 2016, everyone was hyping up Hillary Clinton. They were saying she had it in the bag and she lost. Then there's Joe Biden. Well, he did win, but by the skin of his dentures, I mean teeth. All right, that's being mean. And we're seeing the same thing happen now. Kamala, it took her campaign 48 days to put her policies on her campaign website. Who's running this operation? And the person who coded it still had the Vote Biden code on it. Now, they did fix it. Fine, whatever. But it shows that this is a half-hearted attempt with a team that is doing everything half-assed hoping and praying that the American people suffer from enough Trump derangement syndrome that they'll go ahead and fall in line and follow the orders by voting for Kamala. But that probably is not going to work because these polls mean nothing. These numbers mean nothing. What's going to happen is how many people turn up to vote. Turning up to vote at the voting stations to cast their vote. And it's looking to me that, again, it's 50-50. And the reason why I'm calling it 50-50, it's depending on which of the candidates can get most of their voters to be more than happy to get up off their couch, their chair, wherever, and go ahead and vote. But what does Kamala stand for? She stands for nothing. She's just somebody who was appointed. She wasn't voted in by the Democratic primary voters. She was appointed, anointed. She didn't earn it. This was a last-minute Hail Mary. And so, Democrats, this is all you. This is the person who you're going to have representing your political party. And if things do go south on election night, let's say Trump is to get reelected, this could potentially be a severe gut check to the Democratic Party. No, they won't change their ways, but as a political party and an institution, they're going to get hit hard. Now, whether or not people wisen up to the fact and leave and break away from the Democratic Party is something altogether. Because all the Democratic Party is offering you is just nothing but false hope. And if you feel comfort by those empty word salads, just remember, if you're a diehard liberal and you're doing okay for yourself, when you walk out in the streets, especially in these major metropolitan cities, and you see the homelessness continue to rise up, businesses being shut down, Americans being kicked out of their homes and apartments, just remember, there is no plan. And you are next.